On the screen right now, you're just seeing the build-up to the hustings. As soon as that begins, I will be switching live. But for the meantime, this is Jubes and Kerr. I'll be back on Monday at 6 o'clock. But look, look what I've got, everyone. I've got my popcorn. I am ready for these hustings. Are you ready, Andrew Pearce?
Yeah, very ready.
You ready?
I can't wait.
Do you actually still have faith, both of you, I've got to ask you this, in your chosen ones?
I think the key thing is, actually, and I've spoken to a lot of members, I did an event up in Milton Keynes yesterday, done events across the country, in my own constituency, in Lancashire and in Surrey and Kent as well. I think there's a lot of the membership are still undecided. Some of them undecided whether to vote or not, but I think a lot undecided between the two candidates.
Why would a member not vote?
Some of them are still just really not sure about either of them.
And I'll tell you another reason
really
why.
Split across.
A lot of Tory members are outraged that Boris Johnson was toppled by MPs.
Yes.
He won with a majority of 80, the biggest majority since 1987. They weren't as incensed about Partygate and all the other stuff as others, and they're furious, and they look at Sunak and they look at Truss and think neither of them are a patch on Boris, who, for all his faults, was an incredibly charismatic politician. And you wouldn't say that particularly about these two.
No, I stuck with Boris right to the end. You know, I was on his election campaign as a press guy, and then I was elected as an MP a few months later. And, you know, I didn't resign when he was under real pressure. You know, I was approached by Liz back in October to go for one of her Fizz with Liz things. Obviously, we all know about a few months later, Rishi's website and stuff. I think it's quite clear that the membership consider both of them were sort of thinking about what to do for the future for quite a long time. But I've got to take a realistic view now. And that's why I'm backing.
Stephen says definitely the new PM has a mandate. Right, let's go over to Manchester. Let's get stuck in. GB News, the Conservatives hosting is about to begin. Over to you.
Please welcome your host for tonight from GB News, Alistair Stewart.
Good evening from Manchester, and a very warm welcome to our GB News viewers on television, our listeners on radio, and those following these events online, and of course to Conservative Party members watching at home. Over the next 2 hours, we will hear from both the candidates vying to be the next leader of the Conservative Party, and of course, our next Prime Minister. I'll be putting my own questions to them, but much more importantly, so will our brilliant audience of Tory party members live here in Manchester, who ultimately are amongst that group of people who will pick the winner. GB News has had no pre-sight of the questions, and I have absolutely no idea what they're going to be asking, and that is what helps makes this so exciting. This is the GB News Conservative Hustings, live from Manchester. Well, he is the man whose resignation, along with that of Sajid Javid, really kicked off the events leading to this leadership contest. Rishi Sunak enjoyed the overwhelming support of his Conservative colleagues in the House of Commons, but now admits that he is the underdog in the race to succeed Boris Johnson. He's made his campaign about restoring trust in politics, about defeating inflation, rebuilding the economy, and reuniting the country. In a moment, we'll hear from the man himself, Rishi Sunak. But first, an introduction from one of his supporters.
Please welcome to the stage, Councillor Oliver Johnston.
Ladies and gentlemen, friends and colleagues, welcome to Manchester. My name is Oliver Johnston, and I'm a proud Conservative councillor from Stockport. I first joined the Conservative Party almost 15 years ago, at the tender age of just 17, a time when we had been out of power for over a decade, and right here in Greater Manchester, we had one single member of parliament. We were surrounded on all sides by Labour and Liberal Democrat MPs and councillors, often wondering if there was a Conservative future for our region at all. It was said by the judge and dramatist Sir Edward Abbott Parry that Manchester is the place where people do things. Don't talk about what you're going to do, do it. That is the Manchester habit. And so we did, friends, so we did. Over the last 13 years, we have ceased talking amongst ourselves and started to tackle the issues that the people of Greater Manchester and the people of Britain wanted us to tackle. We refreshed and renewed, and the public placed their faith in our party. We won Bolton West, Hazel Grove and Cheadle, followed shortly by Bolton North East, Haywood and Middleton, Lee, Bury North, and yes, of course, Bury South, which voted for a Conservative and deserves to be represented by a Conservative. All of this we achieve, colleagues, because we are not afraid to renew, tackle the key issues and put in the hard graft. So again, the time has come for us to reflect, renew ourselves and prepare for the hard graft of delivering for the people of Greater Manchester and the United Kingdom as a whole. People are worried. They are worried about rising inflation and how they are going to pay their ever-increasing energy bills this winter. We need a leader with a plan, and that is Rishi Sunak. As a first priority, he will work to bring inflation under control. He is right to do so. Inflation makes people, all of us, poorer. He will put in place immediate direct support for households, particularly for the most vulnerable this winter. Let's not forget that failure to do so will punish us, the Conservatives, at the ballot box. Rishi is ready to lead and will grow our economy and encourage investment, both here in the birthplace of the Industrial Revolution and across the country. Rishi Sunak will roll up his sleeves in Number 10 and get to grip with the backlogs in our National Health Service by bringing down waiting lists. And he will turbocharge the building of new homes on brownfield sites whilst protecting our precious Greenbelt. Finally, he will ensure that we, colleagues, are ready to fight the next general election with more resources for our target seats and will empower us as members to lead that fight. For what, as our party chairman has just said, is the alternative? An emboldened Labour Party in government with plans for more borrowing and higher taxes to fund the ever-burgeoning socialist shopping list, saddling our children and grandchildren with eye-watering levels of debt and strangling future growth. My friends, we need a leader, a Prime Minister, who will not shy away from frank conversations with the people of Britain and the tough decisions of government. In the immortal words attributed to the late Ian MacLeod, socialists can scheme their schemes, liberals can dream their dreams, but we in the Conservative Party have work to do. Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to introduce the man to lead us in this vital work, Rishi Sunak.
They say beware the underdog, because an underdog has got nothing to lose. An underdog fights for every inch. They work harder, stay longer, think smarter. Underdogs don't give up. They'll do the difficult things, and they never ever get complacent. So, write them off if you like. Sit back and dismiss them. But if there's one thing I know to be true, it's that Britain loves an underdog.
Please welcome to the stage, Rishi Sunak.
Thank you. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. It is great to be with you tonight. Now, I'm standing here in front of you for one very simple reason, and that's because our country did something extraordinary for my family. It welcomed them here as immigrants years ago and allowed them to build a better life in Britain. Now, I was raised with a few simple values. First is that family means everything to me. Because we as Conservatives know, don't we, that the bonds of family are far greater than anything any government could ever hope to replicate, and we must never, ever forget that. Now, in my family, we prioritised hard work as the way to forge ahead in life. My dad was an NHS GP. My mum ran the local chemist in Southampton, where I grew up, and I spent all my time working in her shop, out and about delivering medicines to patients and doing her books, seeing the power of that small business to provide jobs in our local community. And for my parents, there was one thing that they believed above all else would be the way to provide a better future for their three children. And it was simple. It was through education. And that's why today I passionately believe that the best way that we reduce inequality in society, the best way that we spread opportunity, indeed, the best way that we transform people's lives is by ensuring that the birthright of every child is a world-class education. So, and that, in a nutshell, are my values. Patriotism, family, service, hard work. And I know, as I look out at you, that those are your values too, and that's because they are Conservative values. And that's why I want to be your Prime Minister, to put those values into action to build a better Britain. But how are we going to do that? Well, I believe we need to do three things. First, we need to restore trust. Then we need to rebuild the economy. And we must reunite our country. Now, when it comes to restoring trust, for me, that starts with honesty. And as you can see in this leadership race, I have not chosen to say the things that people may want to hear. I have said the things that I believe the country needs to hear. And even if that doesn't make my life easy, it is honest. And for me, that is what leadership is all about. But we'll also restore trust by delivering on the things that matter to people. That's why I've set out a plan to finally start reforming the NHS so that we can talk less about how much money we're always putting into it and more on the healthcare that we want to get out of it. It's why I want to take on this lefty woke culture that seems to want to cancel our history, our values, and our women. And it's why we need to restore trust of communities right here by calling out the failures of the Labour Mayor Andy Burnham, because it simply isn't good enough. I mean, just look at the record. A police force that was put into special measures, the highest rates of knife crime almost across the UK. Now, I will make sure that the police have the powers to do their job, and whether it's stop and search or other, I will never let political correctness stand in the way of keeping us safe. And we saw him again today, a day of strikes, of Avanti-cancelling trains. And whilst the Conservative Party was sticking up for hard-working families, the Labour Party and Andy Burnham were on the side of the unions, and the British people deserve better. But also, we need to restore trust back into our planning system by putting you, local communities, in charge of the development that happens in your areas so that you can protect your precious greenbelt. And it's why I've set out a radical plan to finally get to grips with illegal migration. Because for too long we've turned on our TV screens and seen the scenes of people coming here, boats illegally, and it is wrong. Now, when it comes to rebuilding the economy, I don't need to tell all of you what the problem is. You know that the challenge is inflation. Inflation is the enemy. It makes everyone poorer. It eats into people's hard-earned savings, their pensions. It pushes up mortgage rates. And this autumn and winter, I will make sure that we support especially the most vulnerable through what will be a difficult period. Cutting VAT off energy bills, but going further for those who need more help. But what I will not do is pursue policies that risk making inflation far worse and lasting far longer, especially if those policies amount to borrowing £50 billion and putting that on the country's credit card and then asking our kids and our grandkids to pick up the tab, because that is not right. Now, I will cut your taxes and I will cut income tax because I want to make sure that under a Conservative government that I am privileged to lead, hard work always pays. But I'm going to deliver those tax cuts responsibly by being tough on public spending and by growing our economy. And that's why this autumn I will radically change how we tax businesses, cutting taxes for those businesses that are doing the right thing, investing in expanding their manufacturing plants, innovating to create the products and services of the future, because those are the tax cuts that will drive growth in a modern economy. And I'll also continue investing right here, levelling up in town centres and high streets with new transport infrastructure, making sure that we spread our R&D money across the United Kingdom. And as someone who was proud to vote for Brexit, we need to make sure that we capitalise on it, and that means cutting EU red tape. That's why I created the brand new Brexit policy of free ports and put one right here in the Northwest. I was a Chancellor that delivered for the North, and I will be a Prime Minister that continues to deliver for the North. Because in 2 years' time, we have to reunite our country. We have to do something special, my friends. We have to do something that's never been done before. We have to win a fifth general election in a row. Now, even though that is making British political history, I believe that working together, all of us can do it. But it is going to require us to appeal to swing voters everywhere, in the North and in the South, in Brexit areas and Remain areas, Liberal areas and Labour areas, in Wales and in Scotland. And I firmly believe that I am the candidate that offers our party the best opportunity of beating Labour and ensuring that Keir Starmer never walks through the doors of Number 10 Downing Street. And in conclusion, let me just say this. You saw me as Chancellor in the pandemic, acting boldly and radically to successfully safeguard our economy through the biggest storm in 300 years. Now, as Prime Minister, I promise you, I will apply that same urgency and grip to every other aspect of government to build a better Britain. A Britain where our children can walk safely on the streets at night. A Britain where our NHS is reformed and efficient and there for everyone. A Britain where our schools and apprenticeships are the envy of the world in providing opportunity. And a Britain where our economy is the most dynamic it has been, creating jobs in every part of our United Kingdom. But I also promise you this, perhaps more importantly, that I will give you my all to ensure that each and every one of you here tonight can always feel enormously proud of the Conservative government that I will be privileged to lead. So I humbly ask for your support, not just to be our next party leader, but also the next Prime Minister of our great country. Thank you.
Well, there we have it, ladies and gentlemen. Former Chancellor of the Exchequer Rishi Sunak with lots for party members here live in Manchester, GB News viewers and listeners at home, Conservatives also at home to think about. And we will be returning to Mr. Sunak shortly for some detailed questions from me and some questions from these good folk as well. But before all of that, it is now the turn of the Foreign Secretary, who, of course, has not resigned from Boris Johnson's government. Liz Truss has made her campaign about uniting the Tory party, cutting taxes urgently, and also rebuilding trust in government. We'll be hearing from Liz Truss herself shortly, but first, let me now hand over to one of her supporters.
Please welcome to the stage Member of Parliament for Rossendale and Darwin, Jake Berry.
Good evening, Manchester. Good evening. Come on, you heard them outside. Tories shout, apparently. When I look at this audience, I see my friends. Friends from Liverpool. Friends from Manchester. Friends from Lancashire. Cheshire. Cumbria. And across the northwest. And I know you all because we were out campaigning together in the ice, the wind, the rain and the snow in December 2019. We know that it wasn't Central Office that won that election. We know it wasn't Boris Johnson, fine Conservative that he is. It was you. It was you who carved a path from Greater Manchester to Lincolnshire, the Black Country to Northumberland. Across the north of England and the Midlands, people turned their back on the Labour Party, who for decades had taken their vote for granted. And that now means that we have over 80 Conservative members of Parliament representing the north of England. But it would be a mistake to believe that that was an unconditional vote for our party, the Conservative Party. People didn't just vote Conservative. They voted for change. They voted for action. They voted for delivery. And if we're to win the next general election, we must be led by a Prime Minister who isn't just satisfied with holding those 80 seats, but has a plan so we can win more here in the north of England. And that Prime Minister is Liz Truss. Because poll after poll shows that only Liz can take on Keir Starmer and win at the next general election, leaving him like IKEA or IKEA Starmer even demolished, as flat as one of their flat pack wardrobes at the end of that election. And as Margaret Thatcher told us, in politics, if you want something said, you ask a man. If you want something done, you ask a woman. Liz is that woman of action. She'll show our communities that levelling up is about delivery. Because people who voted Conservative at the last election, they want us to prove them right. They want to stand in their local pub with their friends and tell them how their town is getting better. Liz's plan for government acknowledges it's no longer good enough for us to talk about being the party of low tax. We need to become the government of low tax. Let's lower taxes to level up the North. Bring it on. My friends, to win that historic fifth term in government, we will once again be meeting together on the streets of the north of England. But to do that, we need to be led by a Prime Minister who can unite our party, unite our country, and crucially, deliver levelling up for the communities in which we live. My friends, in Liz Truss, we will have a Prime Minister who dares to do. In Liz we trust. Thank you.
The United Kingdom is a great country, and I know that a united Conservative Party can unleash the potential of all the people who make our country so great. To win the next election, we need to deliver, deliver, and deliver for the British people. I know that our country's best days lie ahead. I'm the candidate with a clear vision for the future who can drive change and get things done. As Trade Secretary, I negotiated deals with allies like Australia and Japan, creating opportunities around the world for British business. And as Prime Minister, I will continue to deliver on the opportunities of Brexit. I will lead a government committed to core Conservative principles: low taxes, a firm grip on spending, driving growth in the economy, and giving people the opportunity to achieve anything they want to achieve, regardless of their background. I will work day and night to lead a party and a government that puts more money in your pocket and secures a better life for you and your family. I've consistently delivered when I have said I would. And I love our country. I want the best for us all. And I'm the person to deliver that.
Please welcome to the stage, Liz Truss.
Hi, hi everybody. It's fantastic to be here in Manchester this evening. Now, I'm not from a traditional Conservative background. I grew up in Paisley in Scotland and in Leeds, where I went to a comprehensive school. And what I saw at my school is I saw children who were let down. Let down because of low expectations, because of the background they were from. Let down because Leeds City Council cared more about political correctness than they did about making sure everybody had the basics in English and maths. And let down because of a lack of opportunities in the area. And I didn't like to see that waste of talent. I didn't think it had to be like that. And that's what drove me into politics, because I want us to be a country where everybody can succeed regardless of their background. I want us to be a country where there are opportunities for all. I want us to be an aspiration nation. Now, I recognise that I'm from the other side of the Pennines. But I do think it's time that we buried the hatchet. After all, the War of the Roses was quite a long time ago. And what I want to see is a successful north of England where everybody has opportunities and we link up the great cities of the north, from Liverpool to Manchester to Leeds and beyond, and also, of course, Bradford. That's why I want to build Northern Powerhouse Rail. And I want those opportunities to be powered by enterprise and business, unleashing investment right across the country. I want us to make the M62 the superhighway to success. But let's be honest, in this city, there is a dark pool. There is the miserablest mayor, Andy Burnham. He doesn't want cars to come into the city. He doesn't want people to be able to get on the train to get into work. He'd rather back the militant trade unions. He doesn't want opportunities for people in this city, and he has to be defeated. Now, I recognise we're in difficult times. We face a global energy crisis. We have an appalling war perpetrated by Vladimir Putin in Ukraine. We've got the aftermath of COVID. And let's be honest, we've had decades of relatively low growth in our country. So now is not the time for business as usual. Now is the time we need to do things differently. We need to be bold. And that is what I would do as Prime Minister. I would unlock opportunity. I would have a clear plan for growth to deliver for our entire country. First of all, that means making the most of the post-Brexit opportunities. I would get all the EU laws off our statute books by the end of 2023. I would use that to unleash investment from the city in places like Alderley Park with a fantastic life sciences. I'd make sure Liverpool Freeport was successful by making the offer deeper and stronger. And I would also make sure that we cut taxes. Because the fact is that we shouldn't have raised national insurance when we said we wouldn't. When we said we wouldn't in our manifesto. I would also have a moratorium on the green levy to save people money on their fuel bills. And of course, we should be doing more to deliver a supply, using more of our gas in the North Sea, getting nuclear on stream quicker to address the root cause of our energy problems. And what I would also do is keep corporation tax low. Because if we raise our corporation tax to the same level as France and 10 points higher than Ireland, we're not going to attract those new opportunities. We're not going to attract that investment here in Manchester and across the Northwest. And fundamentally, as a Conservative, I'm somebody who believes in being on the side of people who do the right thing. The self-employed, people who set up their own businesses, people who work hard, people who go into work every day. That's whose side I am on. Now, before I became an MP in 2010, I was a local councillor. And when I was a councillor, I sat on the planning committee. Now, those are hours of my life that I will never get back. Because we were constantly being overruled by Whitehall or by the planning inspectorate in Bristol. And what I would do is I would abolish the top-down housing targets, and instead, I would level up in a conservative way through low-tax investment zones, driven by local people, attracting enterprise into our area. And what I would also do is make sure the Treasury funding is fair. Too often, there is more money and more investment going into places that have got it already. They don't need it. The people who need the fast broadband and the mobile signal are the people where you can't get it at the moment. And that's what I would focus our efforts on. I'd also make sure we back our farmers. There are fantastic farmers here in the Northwest, but frankly, they're spending too much time filling in forms. We want them producing food because we face a massive food insecurity issue. And to deal with the food insecurity and the energy insecurity, we need to face down Putin in Ukraine. I'm proud that we were the first European country to send weapons to Ukraine. And as Foreign Secretary, I put the toughest sanctions on Russia of any country in the world. But we cannot be complacent about our security. That is why I would increase defence spending to 3% of GDP by the end of the decade. And I'll also make sure that we're dealing with the issue of illegal immigration in the Channel. I worked with Priti Patel, I supported the Rwanda policy, I want to expand it to more countries. But most importantly, we need to legislate in Britain to make sure we can't be overruled by the ECHR. Now, as well as focusing on freedom and democracy overseas, we also need to have freedom and free speech here in Britain. And frankly, too much of the debate has been dominated by left-wing identity politics. I am a plain-speaking Yorkshire woman, and I know that a woman is a woman. Minister, I will protect our single-sex spaces such as domestic violence shelters, and I will make sure women's and girls' rights are protected in our country. And I'll also stand up for our great country. We have a proud history, and there are too many people who talk Britain down and claim we should be ashamed of our past. We're here in the great city of Manchester. You know, there are other fantastic cities right across the country. We should be proud of our heritage. And we should say no to those people who say our best days are behind us. They're completely wrong. Our best days are ahead of us. And it's fantastic to be joined by so many of our members of parliament that were elected for the first time in the North West in 2019. In seats like Lee, in seats like Burnley. I'm not going to mention them all because there are so many of them. There are so many of them. But the people that voted for our fantastic new MPs didn't vote for them because they wanted more Labour policies. They were fed up with Labour. They were fed up with Labour letting them down. They were fed up with being patronised. They were fed up with lack of opportunities, not focusing on trades, not focusing on new industries. So we need to deliver conservative policies. We need to be proud to be conservatives and proud of our values, standing up for personal responsibility, standing up for enterprise, standing up for the freedom to control your own life. And that's what we need to deliver. And I'm somebody who does deliver. Whether it's the dozens of trade deals that I struck at the Department of Trade when people said it wouldn't be possible, or whether it's the Northern Ireland Protocol Bill that was not universally popular in Whitehall, but we got through the House of Commons with a significant majority. I will not take no for an answer. I will deliver for all of those voters who voted for us in the first time in 2019 and all of our other voters. I will make sure we deliver on our promises, and we will open up new opportunities across the north. We will deliver for people, and we will take on successfully at the next election yet another Labour leader from North London, and we will take on Andy Burnham and his negative anti-growth, anti-success attitude. And my friends, we will unleash opportunity across Britain, and we will unleash opportunity here in the North West, and we will win the next election. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Well, that was quite a start, wasn't it, ladies and gentlemen? The pitch then from the Foreign Secretary, following the pitch from the former Chancellor of the Exchequer. So let's get started now with the questioning bit, first of all from me, and as I said right at the very beginning, much more importantly from all of these good people, Conservative members from Manchester and thereabouts, here live tonight. So, first up, please welcome back onto the stage the former Chancellor of the Exchequer, Rishi Sunak. My purpose tonight is to go through three or four substantial areas, hopefully asking stuff that you haven't commented upon, and subsequently I'll do exactly the same with Liz, but to get through that in about 12 minutes' time, and then it's up to these good people out here. You got a big round of applause when you spoke earlier on about law and order, and during the campaign you've made a great deal about sexual exploitation and especially the grooming gangs, not least in Rochdale. But when an 87-year-old man can be killed in his mobility scooter in broad daylight in London, we need more than just words. Isn't it time to put the politicians directly back in charge of law and order, of policing in this country, dispense with the police and crime commissioners, and really let the politicians rip on this issue?
Well, I think, actually, when it comes to police and crime commissioners, we've actually done very well as a Conservative Party, something we should be very proud of. I know Andrew will be proud of it, because we do extraordinarily well at winning those elections, and that's because we are the party that is trusted on law and order, and it's something that the Labour Party is not. But we can't lose that position, so that's why I talk about it. And it's about putting more police officers on the streets. But I think it goes beyond that, and that's what I was talking about when it comes to stop and search with Andy Burnham. And it's why I want to tackle the issue that all of you know is more pervasive in our country than we care to admit, and we don't talk about it enough, and that is the issue of grooming gangs, because it's awful. The crimes that these people commit are pernicious. They affect girls as young as my two daughters, and I want to be tough on it. And that means we need to have a new unit at the National Crime Agency. We need to actually record the ethnicity of the people doing this that we don't do today, and that is wrong.
Sure.
And
I know that, and with due respect, you've said that, and you're on the record about it. What I haven't heard from you is what you're going to do to make our streets safer, like the 87-year-old man stabbed to death in his mobility scooter.
Yeah, well,
practical approaches from Camp Sunak.
Yeah, so tackling knife crime comes stop and search is the thing that we know makes an enormous difference. It's actually the powers that we are trialling in other areas in the country that allow the police to stop and search previously convicted knife criminals, which actually I want to bring here to Greater Manchester, because it would make a difference, because knife crime here is among the highest in the country. And as I said in my speech previously, and I stand by it, we should not let political correctness stand in the way of keeping people safe.
And that means putting the Justice Secretary in charge of parole boards, and an elected politician overruling a parole board if needs be, if a sentence is being softened or someone's being let out early.
It means toughening up our sentencing, but particularly, and this is actually very relevant for knife crime, actually everyone should know this, right? So 50% of the convictions in our country are committed by less than 10% of criminals, right? So there is a small group of people who disproportionately account for the crime in our country. Now, the average number of crimes that these people commit, just so you know, is 19, right? And I think all of us, compassionate Conservatives, believe in giving people a second chance. Probably we believe in maybe even giving them a third chance, but we don't believe in giving them a 19th chance, do we?
Right.
Right? So we need to toughen up sentencing for these types of criminals.
On the National Health Service, got applause on that when you spoke earlier as well. You say you want to call out poor leadership, but many feel that the NHS itself, love it as we all do, has become a system that's simply not fit for purpose. isn't it time for a profound restructuring and for you to say, if you're Prime Minister, not a penny more until it's functioning properly, meeting targets and achieving better outcomes?
Yeah, so I've already... I mean, Alistair, that's broadly what I have said. Because, look, the NHS is the service that people most rely on. And it is something that we have to be trusted on. And it's something that's under enormous strain.
You've been clear on the ambitions. You haven't been clear on the reforms.
Yes, I have been, right? So let me give you one example. I will give you one example of a reform. Because if we are not prepared to be bold and radical about making the NHS more efficient, we will never be able to get better quality healthcare. We'll never be able to get people's taxes down responsibly. So here's one thing that I'm just going to say to you now, out of the many things I want to do, to give you a sense of what I want to do. And that is to tackle an issue that we all know exists, but we haven't done anything about for a long time that costs us. And that is the issue of missed NHS appointments, right? Last year, and I see lots of nodding because you all agree and you see it, 15 million. 15 million missed appointments in the NHS, not just at GP surgeries, but at hospitals too. Now, not only does that not value our doctors, it also deprives people of the care that they urgently need. So if we can get tough on missed appointments, then that's not about making money. What this is about is changing behaviour in this country, so that's not acceptable. Because if people cancel these appointments in advance, what do? We suddenly free up all this extra healthcare, all these extra appointments to get the backlogs down quicker, get people seen, and it has not cost a person here a penny in extra taxes.
Sure.
Now, that is an example of something bold and radical that lots of people will say, oh gosh, it can't be done, or it's too tough. But if we're not prepared to get radical on the NHS, get efficiency out of it, we will never reform it, and I will never cut your taxes, and that's what I want to do as Prime Minister.
Let me try and tempt you to be radical on something else as well on the health service. A lot of people in this room and listening to this conversation will have scrimped and saved from their hard-earned money to buy private health insurance so that they can get to what they need sooner and, funnily enough, alleviate some of the pressures on the NHS. Would you, as a former Chancellor, consider giving tax relief to the people who decide private health is the way for them to go?
Yeah. So, I mean, when it comes to tax policy, it's something that's been pitched to me in the past and I'd happily look at it, but I'm not sure that is going to move the needle when you think about the vast majority of how people use the NHS. If we want proper NHS reform, at the margin, people moving to the private sector isn't going to change the overall dynamics. But I do want to learn from the private sector, right? I have a background in business.
Yeah.
Now look at how the private sector does elective surgery for hip and knee operations. Those are very routine operations. The private sector does them very effectively in surgical hubs. And I want to replicate that model in the NHS, change how we do that type of surgery. It's something that the doctors really prefer. They're far more efficient during the day. They can crack through many more operations. And again, it's not about more money. It's about bringing a different mindset, a private sector mindset to the NHS. And I want to roll out those surgical hubs across the country because that's how we'll get the backlogs down. That's how we'll get people treated better. And that's how we'll reform the NHS. But these are some practical ideas. That's what I'm going to do.
That's what I wanted. On immigration and what's going on day in, day out in the English Channel, on the French coast and in Dover, you said just a few minutes ago, it's wrong. Mm. You're clear on your attitude towards the Convention on Human Rights. You're clear about wanting to reform it. But isn't it time for you also, perhaps tonight, to embrace your supporter David Davis's plan to instruct Border Force and the Royal Navy to push those floating dinghies back?
Yeah. So, look, first of all, there's a reason I mentioned this up front. Because, look, I sit here in front of you all as a result of our country's unbelievably proud, compassionate history in welcoming people to our shores. But that has to be done legally. It has to be done fairly, because if it's not, it undermines trust in the system. And every time someone sees a boat coming here, it means that they trust our migration system less, and it means that they're less willing to support us welcoming people who genuinely need to be here. And that's why we must fix it. It's part of why I voted for Brexit, proudly. Now, what do we have to do? Now, look, David's idea, many others have said that as well, and as the Prime Minister's already said, no option should be off the table with regard to that. It is trickier to implement that in the channel. channel and given the boats that we're faced with compared to how the Australians do it where they are. But look, no option should be off the table. But again, in the interest of being practical here and not just talking in abstract, let me give you two very specific things out of my 10-point plan, which is online for those of you who want to go and have a look at it, that I want to do. The first is very quickly move away from the European definition of what an asylum seeker is. Because it is too broad, it gets exploited by lefty lawyers and means that we can't send people back who shouldn't be here. We can move to a different convention and we should do it as soon as possible. That's the first thing. And if you want one other thing on that, I tell you, we've got to toughen up our foreign policy. Because at the moment, we have a situation, which you will find, I found it bonkers. We will go to a country, we'll talk to them about a trade deal that we want to do with them, right? We'll also potentially be giving them actual foreign aid. But at the same time, we don't say to them, hang on, you need to take back your failed asylum seekers. Well, that's clearly wrong. So we've got to get tougher with our foreign policy and join those things up. Because okay. When people shouldn't be here, we must be able to send them back. It's as simple as that, and I will do whatever it takes to make it work.
I want to end on a big question, and if I've got time after that, a couple of rapid-fire ones. But the big one is this. Take you back to the heady days of your spring statement, which you will remember, I'm sure, in which I jotted down, as a reporter, one of the standout comments, which was, I can't do everything. You said within that statement. And then in your Mays lecture, which I also listened to and read very, very closely, you said, and I quote, we can't accept these levels of public spending as the new norm. If you win and lead this party and become our next Prime Minister, you can redefine what it means to be a post-Johnson Conservative in the 21st century. Smaller state rather than bigger state. Lower levels of spending rather than endless levels of spending. What is the Sunak vision of how Britain should be through Conservative eyes?
Well, you framed it very specifically in the context of what the government should do, because that's also a very big question. But the answer to that question for me is very simple, right? It starts with what I said at the dispatch box actually last year. And I was the first cabinet minister to actually say this, and I'm sure all of you will agree with it. But that's because we're conservatives. And what I said was, very simply and plainly, because it needed saying, is that government can't do everything. But more than that, government shouldn't do everything. We are conservatives. We believe in personal responsibility. We believe in families. We believe in communities. And yes, COVID happened, but that is not the norm. We've got to be willing to actually just make the argument, because all the pressure is always there. And as that's what you've seen over the last 2 years, that's not me. I don't wake up every morning and when a problem comes my way, think, oh, well, how can the government spend some money to solve this problem? That is wrong. That's not what a Conservative government should do, and that is not what I will do as Prime Minister.
My final question, and you and Liz both know, I don't do gotcha moments. I hate it and I loathe it and I don't go for it at all. But I was listening very carefully to your opening video, Underdog. As a Southampton Football Club fan, how do you get back to winning ways?
Well, unpopular for saying it here, starting by beating United this weekend. There we go.
my producer said you should ask him, what's the most difficult job at the moment, to become Prime Minister or manager of Manchester United?
Well, I tell you. I have been out and about, as you saw on that video, across the country. And I've spoken to thousands of our members. It's so wonderful to see so many of you here tonight. And wherever I'm going, I find that my message is resonating. I am winning the argument about tackling inflation, being responsible with our borrowing, about actually supporting vulnerable people this autumn and winter, which my plan will do, Liz's plan does not do, about actually reforming our tax system so it delivers growth, right? And everyone here I heard, and we should talk about it in the Q&A, applauding Liz on corporation tax, we should talk about it. Because everyone applauding, I want to persuade you that you're wrong. Right, everyone applauding the fact that we should cancel the NHS levy and have our kids borrow and pay the bill for that. I want to tell you that you're wrong.
Right, I'm going to stop you right there.
But all I'd say is, wherever I go, I'm finding it's resonating. And all I can say to everyone here is, I will fight till the last day of this contest, and I plan to keep going until the end.
Rishi Sunak, ladies and gentlemen.
Okay, so where have we got? I'll wander around, but you want to call some people out?
Okay, where are my friends with microphones? Are you a microphone person? Right, can you come right down? Bless you. They hate me when I do that, but it's good for everybody. Gentleman right there, four in, blue shirt, spectacles. Name and regiment if you want, don't have to. Your question to Mr. Sunak. And as your chairman said, short and sharp, please, we'll get more.
Simon Moorhead, in the medium term, I'd like to know what you're going to do about energy and food independence. And in the short term, I'd like to know what you're going to do about the pensioners who've got the choice of heating or eating when it becomes very cold and they don't pay taxes. So it's heat or eat in the winter.
Yeah.
Thank you.
That was cheeky because those are two massive questions.
I know it's cheeky, but that's fine. But
they're great ones. They're great ones, Simon. So let me answer them both. Right. Look, your first one on actually, you know, where was I today earlier on? Right. I went to talk to the NFU at their headquarters to talk to all their farmers. Why? Because I passionately want to support British farmers. I represent one of the most rural parts of our country in North Yorkshire. It's a privilege for me to call it home. And it's a privilege for me to represent so many farmers where I am. And that's because food security is incredibly important. And we haven't focused on it enough. I plan to do so. That means lots of things. It means making sure that our agricultural programs support farmers to produce food and not do 20 other things. It means protecting agricultural land from development of solar farms. It means making sure that we get our trade deals right and not actually sell them out too soon and too quickly in the way that they feel that they have been and bring them along on the journey with us. So there's lots we can do to support them. But I'd say this, it's as simple as this, and there'll be some people, I'm sure, from rural parts of the Northwest, like Cheshire here tonight. You know, I represent more farmers than any other part of this country, according to the NFU. My neighbour is a dairy farmer, and I represent certainly more sheep than people. So if I don't deliver the most pro-farming government, I won't literally be able to go home every week. It's as simple as that.
Thank you very much, Nick. We've got a microphone on this side.
This pensioners question is really important.
But very, very quickly, because otherwise people won't get in.
No, but I think lots of people have the same question. Look, this winter, it's going to be incredibly difficult. People's energy bills are going to go up by over £1,000, £1,500. And I think the right thing for a compassionate Conservative government to do is to provide support to the most vulnerable people. And yes, we should cut VAT, and I will do that, and that will help everyone. But there are two groups of people that need specific help, those on low incomes and pensioners. And my view is that they should get direct help. So alongside the winter fuel payment, I will provide extra financial assistance to our pensioners. Now, Liz's plan is to cut taxes. Right? And she said that she rules out direct financial support. So all of you, when you're applauding that and we don't do it, you've got to ask the question, well, how are we going to help these millions of people if we've ruled out directly supporting them? They don't pay tax, the vast majority of them. The third of British families on very low incomes, that tax cut that you're applauding and that she's proposing provides about a quid a week to those people. It is not going to help them. And if the British Conservative
last
government...
Last point, Rishi, otherwise we are really going to run out of time.
...goes through the autumn and winter and does not provide direct support to those vulnerable people, I believe it will be a moral failure and the British people will never forgive us. And if I'm Prime Minister, I will not let that happen.
Next question, woman in the front row here.
Right.
I'm a borough councillor for Culture, Glathery and Croft in Warrington. We're very concerned about the Greenbelt, and we're seeing local plans being published and Greenbelt taken inappropriately. Land is being taken where currently crops are growing in our village, and next year they're planning to build on it. Will you commit today to quickly bring in some rules to stop this land grab, which is happening right now?
Thank you.
Yes, the quick answer is absolutely yes. I've already committed to doing it. I want to change our planning system so we get rid of top-down targets and we have very strong protection for the Greenbelt, so there should not be inappropriate development on the Greenbelt. We can do it quickly, and we also need to stop particularly urban mayors trying to push development out to the Greenbelt in largely conservative areas. I will stop that from happening.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you. Woman in the front row there.
Yes. Hello, good evening.
Hi.
Yes, I just want to know, you mentioned that you're going to tackle inflation. I have the dubious distinction of remembering the 1970s. We had rampant inflation and we had unions out of control. You say you're going to manage inflation. You didn't actually mention about controlling unions because the two things are connected. What is your plan on those two issues, please?
So on the unions, on this actually there isn't, I think, an enormous amount of disagreement between Liz and I. We completely agree. We need to crack on and pass a piece of legislation
that means that unions will be, if they strike, they still have to provide a minimum level of service on critical infrastructure like our railways, because they should not be allowed to hold the country to ransom in the way they are. I will pass that legislation. I think Liz has said the same thing, and that's how we'll tackle that problem. But look, your first point on inflation is the right one. And it was right that you mentioned the 70s. And that's the lesson we all need to learn. That's what I talked about when I said we've seen this story before. That's why Nigel Lawson and other Thatcher-era cabinet ministers are supporting my economic approach, because I think it is an enormously risky thing to do to borrow £50 billion, which is Liz's plan, and pump that into an economy where inflation is already spiralling to 13%, interest rates are already rising. That might feel good for 5 minutes, but it is an enormous gamble with your pensions, your savings, with mortgage rates, that inflation gets out of control. That's what happened in the 70s. I don't want to repeat the mistakes of the past. It's not a gamble that I'm prepared to take, and I don't think a sound Conservative government should pursue that approach, because it puts fuel on the fire.
Thank you both very much indeed. Question from this block here. Can you stand up? Thank you, sir.
Hi, good evening, Mr. I'm a genuine undecided, so I don't know yet who I'm voting for. You have asked this question on the Sky News debate, and I don't think you properly answered it. And it's about NHS dental care, which I've experienced recently. Loads of dentists across the country in the NHS that have not taken on new patients. I managed to get on one recently, and I live in Manchester. It's in High Wycombe. What would you do to fix it?
Well, I think since then I've actually put out some proposals on dentistry, which you can go and have a look at online. I think we need to look at the dental contract. But the other thing that I've said very specifically that we do need to do is the money that we give to the NHS for dentistry, that is in theory meant to be ring-fenced for dentistry, is not clear that it actually is finding its way to dentistry. And in the same way that social care for too long has been the kind of poor cousin of the NHS, and the NHS will swallow up all the money, we need to make sure I fix that as Chancellor to get the money to social care specifically. In dentistry, I've said we need to make sure that that's happening, because it's not clear that the funding we put in at the top actually comes to dentistry at the bottom, and that is an easy and simple thing that we should address very quickly to put more resources in.
Better than Sky.
Okay. I think I did okay in that Sky debate, okay. In memory.
Woman there.
Kay Burley was very upset at the end, as far as I could tell, that I had done so well.
No product endorsements.
Hello.
Woman there.
Hi, Richie. My name's Joanne, and I'm a parish councillor in Warrington. I would like to ask you about income for lower middle class families, because in my constituency, they were the ones to give to food banks, and now they're the ones that are in need, and they're going to be struggling this Christmas. They're not going to be able to get benefits. They're not earning high enough money to get to be able to pay for a lot of the shopping and a lot of the bills that are now coming higher due to inflation and tax issues. They're professional, hard-working people who you talked about. They're family-orientated. They're going to find it very difficult to provide for clubs, to buy equipment for their children, for sportswear, etc. How are you going to help lower middle-class families who can't get some of the benefits that you've described?
So, Joanne, I completely agree with you that those are exactly the people that we need to make sure that we're on the side of. That's why one of the last things I did as Chancellor was deliver a tax cut, which was directly targeted at those people. And it was raising the amount of money that everyone can earn before they pay a penny of national insurance or income tax. Now, that happened in July, right? It means you can now earn 12 and a half grand. And it means that's a £330 tax cut for all of those people that you're talking about, right? And if there's two of them in the family, that's obviously a good chunk of cash. That's why the support I announced as Chancellor, taking money off energy bills will help them, £550 this year. And I will go further by cutting VAT off energy bills, which will almost be another couple of £100. So that is all the support in place to help people like that, as well as things that we've done elsewhere. But I tell you this, the best way to help those people is to make sure that this is only going to be tough for one winter. Because it is going to be tough, and there's no point pretending otherwise. Inflation running at 10, 11, 12, 13% makes everyone poorer. Anyone saying that that's not going to happen is not being straight with you. But what I want to make sure is that we get through this winter, and then this is the end of it. That we get inflation back under control and declining. We get our economy growing so I can start cutting income tax, and I've got a clear plan to deliver that, because that is how we're going to help those families. What we're not going to help them by is doing things that might make us feel better for 5 minutes this winter, and then suddenly we've got a big inflation
inflation problem. And because if we're all here talking about inflation next year, right, we're all stuffed, right? Those families that you talk about are going to be furious with us, rightly, because we will have let them down and we will have thrown away the next election by making the mistakes now of letting inflation run out of control. And I don't want that to happen. Okay. How are we doing for time, Alex?
No, I promised I wouldn't do this unless I thought it was vital. But on getting inflation down by the end of the year, back to Bank of England target levels of 3% from where it is now, 10%.
No, we've got to get it going down next year.
But when will it be back to where the Bank of England...
I can't stand here and tell that precisely. So equally, but what I can tell you...
say there won't be inflation next year.
No, there's inflation every year. It's about how much it is. But what exactly. I can tell you is that with my plan, because I'm so focused on it, we will get it down faster than we will with any other plan, because it's the thing that I'm most worried about and that I will most focus on to do.
Great question. Thank you very much indeed. Gentleman there.
Hello, I'm Leo Shepherd, and I'm from the chairman's constituency of Pendle. In June of this year, I was withdrawn from my college after I made tweets in support of the government's Rwanda policy. Now, this isn't just an isolated issue. There are constantly people being targeted and witch-hunted in our educational institutions as the left wing have infiltrated them so that they can take us down before we've even started. So I'd like to ask Mr. Sunak, if you are elected to be our leader and our next Prime Minister, what will you do to protect freedom in school, freedom of speech in our schools, colleges and universities? Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. Biggest cheer of the night. I mean, very well done. No, look, so very simply, it's wrong what happened to you, right? And it's happening far too often, and we've got to stop it. So practically, what are we going to do? What am I going to do? I want to change the public sector equality duty to make it crystal clear with statutory guidance about the protections contained in that for political and religious beliefs, so that universities are forced to uphold those protections. And right now, they are not. But if we change that, they will have to. But I tell you this, there's one other thing. There's one other thing, because you mentioned schools, because there's another thing we need to look at. And I talked about taking on this lefty woke culture, because right now, I'm sure there'll be many parents here, like me, who are desperately worried about what is being said and taught to their children at schools about some very sensitive issues, right? Now, our values on these things are the values of the mainstream majority of hardworking British people. We should not be afraid of standing up for them. And what I want to make crystal clear is to change the guidance on personal, sexual and relationship education in schools, so that parents will always have a right to know what is being taught to their kids, because it is wrong that they are being denied that today, and we must stop it.
Thank you. Next question from the bank there. Yes, sir.
Your family formerly was benefiting from non-dom status and other tax avoidance allowances in the UK. And you also, it was found that you had said that you were redirecting funds from deprived urban areas in the north and giving it to areas in the south that don't need that. And from a northern perspective, that doesn't sound too good. So I want to know, can you, what are your specific policies in dealing with levelling up, and how are you going to improve the current scheme of levelling up?
Yeah, first of all, so we're sitting here in Manchester, right? But what I would say to you, for you to say that there are places in the south that don't need investment is simply completely wrong, right? And if you think this Conservative government is going to get re-elected by telling everyone who lives in the south that we don't give a stuff about them and they don't have needs, I don't know what planet you're on, right? When I was speaking in Kent. Do you know where I was who I was speaking to? Do you know who was there? There were people there from Thanet, which is one of the most deprived places in England, right? Now, of course, a place like Thanet needs investment. I'm from Southampton. If you didn't know where Southampton was and you just looked at all the stats, it would look pretty much like any other red wall place in the north. Right? As the MP for Southampton, who is a Conservative, has made the point. So if I say this to all of you, as a room full of Northerners, I am the most Northern Chancellor that we've had in 70 years. But if we define levelling up as something that is only for the North, we will pay a political price for it, because that's wrong.
Okay.
And there's one more thing, Alex, on that. But
that's your time.
No, hang on. But look, I stand here proudly
as the most northern Chancellor that we have. I'm going to go home tonight in North Allerton in North Yorkshire. Might do my politics in Teesside, right? There's a reason Ben Houchen, the Conservative mayor in Teesside, is supporting me. There's a reason all the MPs in that region, bar one, are supporting me, because I've helped turn that place blue. Because what have we done on Teesside? We've put a new Brexit-enabled freeport there that's bringing jobs and investment. We've invested in Darlington train station. We've levelled up the high streets in Stockton and Yarm and Thornaby. We've moved the Treasury to Darlington. So I'm proud of my record of delivering for the North, and as Prime Minister, I will keep delivering for the North.
This is where I get booed. Last question, short and sharp.
Hi, Rishi. Energy is a need, not a want. Companies have made windfall profits on the current price cap. So why increase in October? Why not freeze current tariffs and give consumers meaningful benefits during the cold winter months? More help is vital. Just to stick to your current plans will lose us the next general election.
Thank you.
Right. So, you know what, actually, your question, ma'am, is better directed at Liz, because I believe that a windfall profit is the right thing to do. I introduced one as Chancellor because I think it's wrong that companies are making billions of pounds of profit as a result of a war, because we're standing up to Russian aggression. So in these exceptional circumstances, I stood there and said we should have a windfall tax. And I'm going to use that money to provide the support this winter to the people that the lady asked about at the beginning, because it's really important, because I agree with you. So that's my plan. But what you've got to ask Liz is, when she's here, is that she doesn't believe in windfall taxes. Right? She's happy to defend the profits, I think, that these energy companies make. So you should ask her. I think it's wrong. I think we should tax them. I think we should use that money to directly help people. And they need direct support, because a tax cut isn't going to work. If we carry on with that policy of just pretending that tax cuts are going to help all those people and not tax the energy companies, that's how we're going to lose the next election. I tell you that. Not with my plan.
Well said, Mr. Sunak. Yep.
Ladies and gentlemen, Rishi Sunak.
Right. Thanks very much.
Alistair, thanks very much.
My apologies to those who I didn't take. I hope we got a good number there and an interesting range of questions. Watching, and I dare say listening to a good deal of that in the wings as well, was, of course, Rishi Sunak's rival for the leadership. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please give a very warm welcome indeed to Liz Truss.
Hi. How are you?
I'm very well indeed, thank you. I think we know what the first question might be, but we'll get to that in a moment. As you know, the structure is that I chat with you about what I think are four or five headline groups, and many of them will be the same as I've put to Mr. Sunak, but perhaps with variations. And I too am going to start with you on law and order. Bearing in mind that also you're a former Justice Secretary, which I think gives it even greater potency. You have said that you want to get back to basics when it comes to law and order, with police spending their time making our streets safe. When an 87-year-old man can be stabbed to death in a mobility scooter, something profoundly wrong has happened. What are you going to do to put politicians back in charge of making our streets safe, perhaps abolishing police and crime commissioners and having direct intervention, targets and performance?
Well, what happened was absolutely appalling and shocking. And we do need to make sure our police are policing the streets rather than policing Twitter and focusing on the right crimes the public are concerned about. So what I would do is have league tables that compare police forces and how they are performing, so they can really be held to account by the public. And I think police and crime commissioners are an important part of that, and they are performing the right role. But at the moment, we don't have enough transparency on exactly what the police are doing. And we also need the right leadership in the police, but also the right leadership in our big cities. And frankly, you know, Sadiq Khan has let down London. You know, he hasn't focused on delivering the tough messages to the police. So it does require political leadership. It also requires more transparency for the public. And it requires a change of culture, a change of culture in the police focused on the crimes that people are concerned about.
Would consistent failure in your league table result to a change in leadership of a particular constabulary, a particular area, whether it's Greater Manchester, London, or wherever it might be? What sanctions would you introduce? Because league tables are utterly meaningless unless there's some clout behind them.
They're very important. I remember what education was like before we had league tables, and I talked earlier about my school. And the fact is, nobody knew how well schools were performing. They didn't know which school was better. There were rumours that circulated, but there was no hard evidence and data. So I think it does help the police to be held to account by having very clear league tables. And ultimately, yes, you know, if people aren't doing their job properly, they should be removed from the post by the relevant politician.
Thank you very much indeed. On the NHS, again, you're on the record as saying that you want to cut out bureaucracy with fewer levels of management and no more central diktats. Will you go further and have a fundamental review of what the NHS can and cannot do? It is like a religion, like an article of faith in the United Kingdom. People are frightened of criticising the NHS, but the waiting lists, the ambulance times, the delivery is not up to muster at the moment. What would you do about that?
Well, it's absolutely right. There are huge problems with delivery. There are long waiting lists. There are problems with ambulances. It's very hard to get a GP appointment or a dentist appointment. But I don't believe the way to fix that is yet another reorganisation of the NHS. We've been through that before. And all that seems to happen every time there's a reorganisation is we get more levels of management. So what we need to do is actually empower the doctors and nurses on the front line, make sure they are able to deal with the issues the patients are raising. And also, that will increase morale and motivation, because what I hear from doctors and nurses is morale is low. And part of that is because people feel like they're being told what to do from Whitehall rather than understanding the situation in their local area and being able to respond to the patient's needs. So that's what we need to enable to happen. I also think we need to look at things like doctors' pensions. We've got a lot of doctors leaving the profession early because of the perverse way that the pensions work. And we also need to look at, you know, we are facing a very difficult situation because we had COVID, so a lot of operations were pushed off. And during COVID, we had extra people that came and helped in the NHS, retired people, people who were formerly nurses or doctors. I want to ask, what can we do now to encourage those people to help out, to help deal with the backlog, and to deal with this very difficult situation that we face?
Sure. On the waiting lists, what a lot of people, I suspect several in this room, but many listening as well, were able to do because they had private health insurance, was to make their own arrangements and get it done because they wanted to, and in so doing, ease the pressure on the NHS itself. Would you consider, and I put the same point to Rishi Sunak, would you consider offering tax relief to those individuals who say, I'm going to go my own way, I'm going to do my own thing, and you as Prime Minister might just give them 25% back?
So I fully accept, and you know, people have the choice of whether to go private or stay with the NHS, but I wouldn't introduce tax relief. I don't believe that is the answer to the issues that we face at the moment at all. And what I will do is, first of all, deal with these issues of, you know, over bureaucracy. And I think we've all seen it. We've all seen the form filling. There are numerous procedures that nurses and doctors I speak to say they shouldn't really have to do, but they're not allowed to use their own judgment. I think we need to trust people on the front line more. But the other point I make, Alistair, is we face a lot of challenges as a country. We face a massive economic challenge of getting the economy growing. We face the challenge of the energy crisis. We face challenges in the NHS. And one thing I would do if I am selected as Prime Minister is I would empower my health secretary to deliver. I don't think the Prime Minister can run everything from Downing Street. And I don't think the presidential model works in Britain. So it is about appointing good people who can really grip those issues and listen to people on the front line and make sure we're delivering.
One final point before I move it on to the next subject. If I bolt together your answer on law and order and the NHS, it seems to me that a Truss premiership would take a much closer grip on leadership and what is happening in terms of the Home Secretary telling police forces what to do, and you've just said it yourself, your Health Secretary telling the NHS what to do. Is that a kind of stamp of authority on what would be a trust premiership?
But it's about leadership, but leadership...
It's also about changing leaders.
But it isn't micromanagement.
Okay.
Because I think the problem is that we've had too many of these central targets in Whitehall. You've had huge layers of management trying to deliver the targets. The people on the front line aren't able to do common sense things because it goes against the central diktat. So, for example, I met a doctor who said he wanted to work weekends. You know, he wanted to go into the hospital, use the operating equipment at weekends, but he was banned by the local NHS trust. And that is just mad. If you've got somebody who actually wants to help patients, but they're not able to because of, you know, central diktat, that is getting in the way of delivering a good service for patients. And I think good leadership isn't about micromanaging people. It's about trusting people, holding them to account. And if after a period of time, they're not doing a good job, yes, they will need to be replaced.
You've said on immigration, you got big applause when you spoke to it way back at the beginning of the evening, that you support the Rwanda policy, you want to expand it indeed. But everybody in this room and everybody watching and listening knows that it isn't working as a policy. You're clear on what you would do about the Convention on Human Rights if you can't reform it. But isn't it time to consider telling Border Force and the Royal Navy to push back the dinghies?
But that isn't going to fix the problem, because ultimately the people who are travelling to the UK, you know, at the behest of these appalling people traffickers who are trading in human lives, are doing so because they want to live in the UK. And if they get sent back to France, the reality is, what we know happens, is they try and get into the UK again. So what we need to find is a permanent home for those people. And countries like Rwanda, they don't want a brain drain. They don't want large numbers of people leaving. They actually want people to contribute to the future of their economy. So what the way to solve this issue, and I've talked to a number of my counterparts in Europe about this as well, is to find a way of making sure there is a long-term home for people who are involved in illegal immigration. If it is just simply pushing people back and forward across the channel, we are not going to get that long-term solution. And you know, I've been through this with numerous cross-Whitehall meetings. The real issue is, at present, people are able to get on their phone to the lawyers when they get on a plane and evade being sent to Rwanda. And that is the issue we have to fix, and that is about the ECHR.
Okay. A piece that you contributed to back in 2019, reform about budget considerations, has caused...
I think that was 2009.
2009.
Alistair.
I do beg your pardon. It is... it's a typo. It has caused a bit of a stir.
I always thought you had high quality standards at GB News, but...
We do.
It's not the BBC. You know, you actually get your facts right.
Ms. Truss, enough already. None of this was rehearsed, I promise, absolutely. I'm not going to talk about aircraft carriers or doctor's pay. You've mentioned doctor's pensions already. But what I do want to ask you, and this is totally serious now, is what it tells you, albeit several years ago, about your vision of the state, which I told you in Lee, I hadn't heard much of as someone who's watched carefully to this campaign. And I talked to Rishi a moment ago about the Mays lecture and levels of public spending and his vision of the size of the state. Can you define what it means to be a post-Johnson conservative in the 21st century in terms of the size of the state, the ambition of the state, and the bill the state sends to all of these people as taxpayers to pay for it?
My ambition is for the private sector to grow more than the public sector. And one of the problems I think we've got is there's been an assumption by various members of what I call the economic orthodoxy that Britain is a low-growth country. And therefore, everything is static. We have to make sure that we are taxing people to keep up with public spending. That is not my vision. I believe we can get to much higher growth. I believe we can get to 2.5% growth on average in Britain by unlocking opportunity, unlocking capital in our economy, doing all the things like Northern Powerhouse Rail that will help drive economic growth.
But does big government get in the way of that? Does big government get in the way of it?
Over time, I want the private sector to be bigger compared to the public sector. And I want a sustainable public sector. You know, we have far too many quangos in this country. We have 500 of them. We need to trim it down to size, and we need to make the government efficient. You know, and there are things like, there are 5 million people who are currently economically inactive. You know, we need to help those people get into work. That will save the government money, but it will also contribute to the economy. So, but that isn't something you can achieve overnight. So my long-term vision is for the state to take a smaller proportion of GDP. But the way we get to that is by unleashing growth and doing all the things like the post-Brexit reforms, speeding up infrastructure projects, having low tax investment zones. That is the way we get to a higher growth country. And ultimately, yes, the government sector will be a smaller proportion of that.
Crucial answer. Thank you very much indeed for that and for mentioning that ratio. I said to Rishi, and I remind you, I don't do gotcha moments, but it's nice, as we did in Lee, to end on...
A gotcha moment.
No, it wasn't a gotcha moment. You eyeballed me and gave a very clear answer about who the cat liked in Downing Street. This one weaves together...
I don't think they know who the cat liked most, but anyway.
Weaves together a serious point, but I hope also... you talked about education in the past and how important it is, and you gave your own lifetime experience right at the very beginning. I'm intrigued to know what you and your husband would say if one or both of your daughters, when the time came up to you and said, you know what, I don't actually want to go to university. What I really want to do is an apprenticeship in X, Y or Z. Would you say hurrah, or would you try and recount your times at Oxford and tell her what a great thing it was?
So I would be delighted, you know, whatever opportunities, you know, either of my daughters take forward. Actually, I think what's most important is what you do, not where you do it. So there are fantastic apprenticeships in areas like engineering and technology that I would be delighted for them to, you know, to go for. Likewise, if they go to university, you know, I am an unashamed, you know, proponent of studying things like maths and physics. So it depends on what course it is, it depends on what apprenticeship it is. But ultimately, you know, you can't tell your children what to do, particularly not... I mean, my oldest daughter is 16, and if I tell her to do one thing, I'm afraid she often just does the opposite. So I'm a practicer of contrarianism. I sometimes lead her down the garden path. I hope, luckily, she's not listening to this, so she won't hear that. But look, by the time your child is 18, I do think that ultimately they have to drive their own future and make those decisions.
Absolutely. Ladies and gentlemen, Liz Truss.
Thank you.
I'm going to go to the audience now if you want
to. Yep, I will.
Now, where are my microphone friends? Ah, there's the first one. Right. Keep coming. There's a gentleman in spectacles there, two rows back. Keep your hat. Yeah, you, sir. And as I said earlier, name and regiment if you want. You don't have to, but your question to Liz Truss.
Tony Johnson, Cheadle. The price of the average house has increased from a multiple of about four times average earnings to nearly eight. Will you please help to significantly increase the number of new homes built so that as to reduce that multiple and increase the number of owner-occupiers?
So the question is about house building. First of all, it's important that we help more young people get on the housing ladder. And what I would do is allow people's rents and the rental history they've built up to contribute towards them being able to get a mortgage. But as I said in my opening comments, the planning system doesn't work. It's Byzantine. It wastes lots of people's time sitting on planning committees. It's constantly overruled by various national policies. And I believe a locally driven planning system that has greater freedom will actually deliver houses where people want, rather than houses where people in Whitehall want them to be. And I think that's important. And my idea of low tax investment zones, which would have simpler planning rules, is you would see businesses built alongside homes, alongside infrastructure. Because what happens at the moment is you get homes just randomly plonked in fields without the infrastructure to support them. And I don't think that works for local communities.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. I'm going to come over here in a moment, but we're just sorting something out technically for a moment. Can we come to this gentleman here?
I'm a magistrate dealing with knife crimes all the time. In fact, yesterday I dealt with a case of attempted murder. And one of the reasons we have knife crimes are that knives are so easily available. If you look at online, highly dangerous machetes and knives, you can buy them for £10. Why can't we ban the sale of those things online?
Thank you, sir.
Well, I think that's a very good point. So we do need to make sure that we are cracking down on access to those types of offensive weapons. And my general view on online is what should be right offline should be right online. So what is legal to buy offline or online should be the same. So that is something that I would look at.
Is that the spoken word as well? Will you amend that legislation?
Yes. I believe in free speech. I think it's important that we protect the under 18s from harmful content. Yeah. But I also think it's important that adults are able to speak freely. Yeah. I think that's a really important...
That's a specific pledge. You've got to go around the floor, sir, to amend that legislation as it sits in Parliament at
that
the moment.
That is a pledge, Alistair.
Thank you very much indeed. Right, over here now, unless I'm being told we can't. We can, bless you. You, sir?
Thank you. My name is Brian Jackson. I'm from Halifax in Yorkshire. Yes, Yorkshire.
I'm glad some people have got over the Pennines into this Hustings.
I'm a mining engineer. I know about these things. And I can tell you that you cannot run, you cannot grow, you cannot progress a modern economy without a secure supply of cheap, abundant, readily available energy. And we haven't got that now. But right here, guess what? Right below our feet is the largest energy bonanza that this country has ever discovered. Bigger than coal, bigger than the North Sea. It's natural gas. It's 1.5 miles below where we're all sitting right now. It's ready to tap. The technology is well proven. It's not dangerous. And I think that somebody in the cabinet, preferably the prime minister, should get behind developing that resource. It's ours. Develop it.
Thank you, sir.
Thinking they know best. I think that's a really important principle.
That may involve overruling.
No, it doesn't. It involves encouraging.
It involves persuading. Okay, gentleman there.
Hi, Liz. Hello. Is it?
Yes.
Yeah, hi. Liz, I'm a doctor of medicine and believes in prevention, preventing the things. And this is a question to you in the capacity of the Secretary of the Foreign Affairs and on the Ukraine war. Now, do you think that the Ukraine war can escalate to a level of a nuclear war? In case that happens, do you have any plan to safeguard the British people, all of us, in a situation like that? Or do you think it will never happen and there is a zero risk and we should be very happy, not bothered about it?
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you, Liz.
So it's in Vladimir Putin's interests to scare people in the West and to go around saber-rattling. What is happening is that he expected to have a clear run in Ukraine. You know, he was expecting to take Ukraine in a matter of days and weeks, and he has failed. And what we need to do is help the Ukrainians succeed. And that is why I have been a major proponent of sending more heavy weapons to Ukraine, as well as putting those tough economic sanctions on Russia. But what we can't do in the face of an aggressor is appease the aggressor or fear what they might do. Because if we don't stand up strongly now, and I'm afraid we didn't stand up strongly enough in 2014 when the Balkanized deal was done, the Minsk Accords, Putin came back worse now. So this is why we have to stand up to him. And the best way of preventing this war escalating is to defeat Putin in Ukraine and ensure the Ukrainians are able to do that.
Liz, thank you. Next question behind you.
Thank you, Liz. I'm Preston City Councillor. My name's Daniel Duckworth. I'm also a member of the Conservative Disability Group. And I'd like to ask what you're going to do to support disabled people, to support disabled people in work and get into work, and also what you're going to do to support people with mental health, because I've got autism myself and depression. What you're going to do to support people with mental health and people in work.
Thank you, sir.
Well, thank you, Daniel. And, you know, as you know, we've been working on a disability strategy, which is all about helping disabled people get into work and have those opportunities and working with employers to do that. And we know at the moment that we need more people in employment. And this is really, really important. And Chloe Smith, the Disability Minister, has been doing a fantastic job on that. We also need to do more to support mental health. And I think mental health has been particularly difficult during COVID. It's been particularly difficult for children and young people. So I want them to have access to mental health support in schools and also in GP surgeries. I support having a mental health nurse in GP surgeries to make sure people are supported. Because in these cases, it's important to help people early. And that is the best way to deal with that issue.
Thank you, Liz. Gentleman in the blue shirt there.
Hello, Liz. Earlier before, you mentioned how young people were let down in your local comprehensive. How would you ensure that the education system doesn't let down any more children in places like Manchester and Leeds?
Well, children were let down. And, you know, I'm proud to have been part of the education department that delivered academies, delivered free schools, delivered the tough new GCSEs, which my daughter has now sat and is not very happy with me. But, you know, we made a lot of changes to the education system to improve it. But it is still the case that a third of all children are leaving primary school without basic English and maths. And we know that if kids get to age 11 without basic English and maths, it's hard for them to succeed in life. So what I want is more specialist maths teaching in primary school, I think is really important. And also making sure that we have the best possible head teachers and the best possible secondary schools. So I'm a supporter, for example, of schools like the Michaela Academy in Brent. Whatever the children's background, you know, Catherine Birbal-Singh believes that child can succeed and won't take no for an answer. It's a no excuses culture. And that is the culture we need to have in as many schools as possible. So I support more free schools like Michaela, more grammar schools in every area so that, I mean, I went to a comprehensive school. I sent both of my daughters to a grammar school, but they only have that choice because we are in a particular part of London. I want people to have that choice right across the country.
Woman in the second row.
Hi, Liz. I want you to explain, please, your plans to get more private sector investment, because at the moment you're planning to just, well, it just sounds to me as if you're just planning on carry on doing what we've always done. Rishi's got a two-point plan. He's saying to the top 30%, invest or pay more tax. You're just saying carry on as is. How does that encourage more investment, please? Tell me what your plan is to encourage more investment.
So two big things I would do to, well, three things I would do to encourage investment. First of all, keep corporation tax low. Because if we raise corporation tax to the same level as France, fewer companies are going to want to invest in Britain. And we know that last time we lowered corporation tax, we got more revenue into the exchequer. Low taxes help deliver more business investment and more growth. The second thing I'd do is get on with the post-Brexit reforms like Solvency II and MiFID. I was told, and I had a round table in the city, that if we change these rules, we could unlock tens of billions of pounds of investment right across the country, I met the people at Alderley Park. They told me that if we unlock these rules, it will mean more investment in Alderley Park and right across the north. There are tens of billions of pounds of investment, but we need to challenge the Treasury orthodoxy to do that, because the fact it hasn't been done for the last 2.5 years. That's why we need to get all of those EU rules off our statute books by 2023. And the third thing I'd do are low-tax investment zones, particularly in areas that have been left behind and are, you know, fantastic towns across the northwest. I want to see low-tax investment zones encouraging business investment, encouraging new opportunities. And that is the way we will drive our economy forward.
Thank you very much indeed. Final question, only because your eyes tell me it's going to be really short and sharp.
Very quickly, I'm a councillor in Salford, which is 2 miles down the road. We have a city Labour mayor, a Manchester County Labour mayor, who constantly, in fact, their reason for doing anything is to borrow more and more money and to ask the government for more and more money. Now, that doesn't sound too far away, at least, from what you're suggesting, that we need to borrow £50 billion. How, in fact, are we actually going to pay that back? How long is it going to take us, on top of all the money that we had to borrow during COVID?
My fundamental view is that we have the highest taxes this country has had for 70 years. And if you have taxes that high, you don't actually get the revenue into the exchequer. And currently, we are forecast to have a recession. And I know what it's like living in places where there is a recession, where people don't have the opportunities, don't have the jobs, the money isn't going into the exchequer. And I'm a Conservative. I believe in low taxes. I believe that by having low taxes, we encourage people to go to work, we encourage businesses to set up, and we encourage the economy to grow. And that is the best way of getting higher revenues in, not by raising taxes to the same level as France.
OK. That's our time. Ladies and gentlemen, Liz Truss. Thank you so much to those of you that I was able to call. Genuine, profound apologies to those that I wasn't able to call. It's the nature of the thing, and I'm really, really sorry about that. But I hope it was a reasonable spread of questions that covered some of the issues that those who weren't called upon were really worried about. And I hope you also felt, as I did, that we had the presence tonight of two pretty candid candidates for you now to choose between. We've heard from both of the candidates. We've heard those brilliant questions from Conservative Party members here live tonight in this room in Manchester. And now they will go away and they will make their decisions on who to back if they haven't already. Tonight's hustings are over, but for us at GB News, the show goes
on. Very honoured to be with President Kagame. We have had tremendous discussions on Rwanda. The job they've done is absolutely terrific. We have trade with Rwanda and just general, I would say, great relationships. I want to congratulate you, Mr. President, as being the new head of the African Union. That's a great honor. This was just announced recently, and that really truly is a great honor. So please give my regards. I know you're going to your first meeting very shortly. And please give my warmest regards, but it's an honor to have you as a friend. Thank you very much.
Well, it was a great honor to meet the President of the United States, President Donald Trump, and we had good discussions on those two levels, the bilateral relations between Rwanda and the United States. Rwanda has benefited tremendously from the support of the United States in many areas where it is in peace support operations we have carried out in different parts of the world. We had the United States on our side supporting us. They have supported our economy in trade, investment. We see a lot of tourists from the United States, visitors sure, coming to Rwanda. And President, I wanted to thank you for the support we have received from you, personnel, and the administration. And we are looking forward to also working with the United States at the level of the African Union, where we are carrying out reforms at the African Union so that we get our act together to do the right things. And that helps in cooperating with the United States. It would be more beneficial when we are organized to know what we want from the United States.
Sure.
For that cooperation, so I thank you very much.
Well, I thank you very much, and it's a great honor to have all of you here. And we'll speak for a little bit longer, and thank you very much.
Membership have actually voted. So what's the state of the race? Sky News has teamed up with YouGov to find out. And here it is. On the basis of this, Liz Truss will be heading into Downing Street on September the 6th. She has a commanding lead. 66% say that they would vote for her. 34% say they would vote for Rishi Sunak. Now, that's actually a slight tightening on a couple of weeks ago, but nothing like on the scale that Rishi Sunak would need to overtake Liz Truss in this contest. Let's look at what's happening underneath the bonnet. And those people who have already voted, which is about 6 in 10, 31% say they voted for Rishi Sunak, 68% say they voted for Liz Truss. So even bigger lead there for Liz Truss. What about people that haven't? Does Rishi Sunak have a chance? Well, he, amongst people who haven't yet voted, 29% say that they voted for him, 44% say they voted for Liz Truss. But look at this, 26% say they don't know. That needs over half of these people to go to Rishi Sunak's corner in order for him to have any kind of chance. The numbers just are so difficult at this stage. But what are the challenges that whoever takes over will face? This poll gave us some clues. The affection that this party has, the Conservative Party, for Boris Johnson, evident in this. We asked, what if Boris Johnson was actually on the ballot paper and he wins by a landslide? 46% say they'd vote for him, 24% for Liz Truss, 23% for Rishi Sunak. This group of people, the Conservative Party, quite clear, they don't think Boris Johnson should have been slung out of number 10 at all in this poll. But what of the toxicity of this race? Lots of mudslinging. But has it rebounded on the membership? Well, the answer appears yes for a big minority. We asked whether Liz Truss should include Rishi Sunak in her cabinet. 52% say yes. But look at this. Over a third of the Conservative Party say that the man that took the Conservative Party and the government and the country through the pandemic and wanted to be Prime Minister should be left out of the next Prime Minister's cabinet. That's quite a degree of dislike of
the US. When they borrow money, they're getting it at 1.5, 1.9 interest rate. Africans, when they get the same amount of money, they're paying 9, 10%. The people who don't need a break, they get a break. The ones who need a break, they don't get a break. The sheer survival of the World Bank, IMF, is based on the fact that African countries and many other developing countries do not succeed. Their success is based on our failure. That has to change. And guess who can make that change? We! The children of Africa, we, the Africans, are the ones who have to say, we know your game now. Enough is enough. We're not playing it anymore. And this is where the diaspora come in. There are more Ghanaian doctors in New York City than in the entire country of Ghana. There are more Nigerian doctors in LA than in the entire country of Nigeria. So let's be serious here. What Africa needs is capacity, capacity, capacity. And that capacity is in the diaspora. So it behooves us to bring the diaspora together, let them understand what is really going on in our Africa. Diaspora are not going home, diaspora angry about Africa because they are not understanding the root cause of why Africa is where it is today. They think getting rid of a president will take care of the problem, far from it. That president is just going to be replaced by another one who is going to equally suffer from the same difficult environment to work in. So let's look at an Africa that must be free to take care of herself, an Africa that's free from exploitation from outsiders. The multinationals who are stealing from Africa every day in broad daylight. I use an example of the DRC. If you ever fly very low over the DRC, you'll see tarmacs in the jungle. You'll see 747s flying into DRC, picking up minerals and flying right out. The same multinationals are responsible for arming young people and giving them MK-16s. Because why? Their satellites in the skies are telling them where that village is. There are lots of diamonds. So what do? Arm young people, drag them up, and send them to go chop off a few heads. The rest of the village runs away so they come behind and do their illegal mining. We black people must understand what is really going on. Because what we are shown instead is, oh, look at those Africans killing each other. There are some serious games that have been played in Africa for far too long. And once we understand that, we can strategize as to how we can begin to bring the difference and bring the change that Africa needs. And that change can only come if the African diaspora are united and the Wakanda villages, as I call them. It is our organized way of saying, starting with one African diaspora center of excellence, it will be a new city, a developmental hub that we can then take from there. Every sector is developed. Take healthcare. How many doctors do we need in this region to take care of this many people? We pick up education, same thing. We pick up engineering. We pick up electricity. How many megawatts of power do we have in the region? How many do we need? Be it solar, be it wind, be it hydro, be it geothermal, be it...
$1, one CV. In the time of Mills and Mahama, two CVs, $1. If I was them, I would say to the people of Ghana, I'm sorry. We are sorry for the poor work we have done. We're going to go and think about ourselves. But that is not the people we're dealing with. The fruits of office, the money under the table has become sweet for them. So they're determined to stay. Are we going to allow that to happen? Are we going to allow that to happen? In Kufuor's time, one of the people who advised and helped him develop a strong city was my running mate, Muhammadu Bawumia. Then he was deputy governor of the Bank of Ghana. It was one of the reasons I brought him to come and join me, that we will welcome the CD and create again a strong CD that will be able to allow us to develop our economy and allow our traders and our work to be able to develop. We have told the world, that under our leadership, we're going to turn our back on the old economy, the raw material exporting economy, and build a new industrial value-adding economy in our country that will bring jobs for our people and for especially for the young people of our country. That is the goal of the new NPP government and the administration and the national government. A competitive labor force. Because we're going to give all the children of our country an opportunity.
What you are singing?
The masters of the field, we're coming. We Uwarian boys are coming. The masters of the field are coming. We Uwarian boys are coming. To win the race, we trust in God, To win the race.
And that's for Lord, and that's for Opokuwari.
Masters are coming. Masters are coming. Mm-hmm. Masters are coming to win the race. Oh, masters are coming. And then they will sing. Prepare the world. Then we go more. Then we'll keep going. Mm-hmm. Then we will sing. When they tire, then we'll come in. Mm-hmm. Diplo Warrens are in the game. We have to win the race and take a cup. We are the masters of the field and best athletes, famous to all and decent boys. How deployed? Then they will start. I'm quiet. I am quiet. Oh, prepare into my best friend.
Hello, Obusia for Kofi Kurantini. Nane. E levy, kasana, ya kasa gana, ubiare kan e levy, inti, se miti bing me. Ni e levy. Because e levy problem no, e simple. Na Ghana government is on peso o tiase, inti ne ye betre mwa chren. No wa tiase ye. Obusia for 2020, IMF ma Ghana. $1 billion, billion with a B. Same year, no World Bank ma Ghana $430 million. Nina for COVID. Ewi echi no in 2021 no IMF for Sama Ghana $1 billion bill. $1 billion with a B. Na World Bank Sama Ghana $130 million. Inti 2021 no, sa $1 billion ne 130 million ya if he World Bank buy any IMF buy no. Now we say post COVID rejuvenation program say what be ma young economy no so. Inti no World Bank ne IMF this is kind of ma Ghana. Ghana government call Bank of Ghana koyi 20 billion cedis say COVID inti. Nebusianfo World Bank ama mu 2 billion. IMF ama mu 2 billion. World Bank ama mu $560 million for COVID. Ano ansom mo san call Bank of Ghana koyi 20 billion cedis say COVID inti. Sia sika no wo mu hun konta nkyre yen ye ana wan bu wo mu ye be bia wo be fa wo Ghana e-levy tax wo ko port a e-levy wo ko airport wo ko hotels be wo dia toto bribiara so wo Ghana e-levy sia sika no he na afa petrol e-levy wo ko union ma port e-levy sia sika no he na afa na inti se ne government person o kyre yen se Ghana fu ebi a yadwene ne nya adwuma nti na ode sa e-levy ne reba yenso ye pese ye kire government se enye se yadwene nya adwuma o ye hu na ekoso no na ye gyai ama no ifi se wo pese wu nya e-levy yen ye ye responsible citizens yen pese ye 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 stand by ye jina ho keka ye twen fa ye ho ono an ka se ye se responsible citizens right nti ye responsible citizens na ne tene se so wo pese wo fihwe sika na wo di ye biribia because yen credit rating record former enye yen abrabo na wo di e-levy ba beto so adenti because there is over 3 almost 3 billion Ghana cedis record to the presidency 3 billion Ghana inti te so by 75% wo to so by 75% a wo save ahe $375 million $375 million save and not at the presidency. You don't need 3 billion Ghana cedis going to the presidency. Deng na wadere ye, Mr. Akufo-Addo. Ene ne koso wo presidency. Deng na mudi sikani ye presidency ho. Mudi ye deng. Mudi shi usuruku ana deng na mudi ye. Legislature, Ghana legislators. Ye wo 275 legislators. Deng na sa legislators no wo ye magana. Say minimum ka say he Ghana fu ye betumi afa I install Watson IBM computer offer ni say Watson no eye artificial intelligence a ebe ye over 90% of young parliamentarians no ye betumi replace one with Watson computer be won adwuma na yen downscale adan ye here 275 parliamentarians out den wo ye magana. One liability to Ghanaians na year over 100,000 cedis every month per parliamentarian. 100,000 cedis. Kona kubun kunta na he. Enu echi, wawo judiciary. Judiciary, he. America, ye 330 million people. 11 times the size of Ghana. Ghana, ye 30.8 million. America, wo 9 Supreme Court judges. Akufo-Addo ba na nsiye yi. Ghana near were 10 Supreme Court judges. Akufo-Addo appointed 8 akaho. Inti say Ghana, a country of less than 31 million people, no, yeah were 18 Supreme Court judges. Deng ne how yang 18. Deng na adeng yang na just a kronga wo we are seen na Ghana ne wunti ye here Supreme Court judges. Deng tin ye wo Supreme Court judges. A country of less than 31 million. 18 Supreme Court judges. Ka, one Supreme Court judge biano liability, ebro $150,000, 150,000 cedis a month. Konako bunkun tahe, ne V8 ordered them, ne bodyguards, ne driver, ne kroneba, then in ti niafa an extra 8 Supreme Court judges. And nun kwan cheng, say a minimum ka say, yeah, what 34 ambassadorial posts around the world. 34 Vatican City. Ah, ewo room cry, ye wo ambassador woho. Deng na ambassador wo Vatican City ye magana. Mun kan chile yenge. A deng ni wo ambassadors wo baby to say Malta nom ne wo friend deng Sri Lanka se Sudan nom ni ade. Deng o komuna yenge ade ba inti ne ye wo ambassadors wo Sudan. It doesn't make any kind of sense. Se wo re e-levy. What is this? Ye san wo 58 diplomatic missions around the world. Diplomatic mission, no, anka hum fasune se wo trade desk, edi income, commerce, bre Ghana. Sa diplomatic missions around the world, they year 58, sika beng wade bre Ghana. Mun kanchere ye near here. E ye krong waste of money and resource. Muse mu hwe e-levy. Ye betchira mu se e-levy no mun kona mun ko yi infi mu amu futum. Positions na mu create a hun nim fasono. E hon na mun ko yi infi. Adeng na mo how Ghana for sa MPP for deng na Ghana for aye munti na debia yentwiase no sa position si na I was here wo over 2000 executive positions are wo executive benefits ne perks wo to kwang wo business class wo nya 4x4 no me ade sa ne me na si wo yifi ho ana wotel so eno no be ma E-levy no income from E-levy ye benya fi ho mroso deng necessary ye ka kire akufu adu ne wo government say sade no munko yi mfi honom na mo boka Ghana foka unnecessarily na mo bewie yi na awie na excavators a nyankopon adom ye nsa ye nsa nkoka ne ye nang na ne mfa nye sika ne mfa ntew ye e levy kason mo abeka kye nsa mo akwo hwe excavators 85 excavators abako ye over 150,000 to 200,000 mo san akwo hwe na ka ho na pan no no wehe yedi cup no wehe tea no wehe ya anom cup no so a wa bona aka ho ei Akufo Addo and his government why Ghana fo ye mpenen de mpene kina E-levy no wona yezbashion wona no wa kwafri scan was aba ye mpen ina le wopene ye no mo ba ba ku ye be jinam de ne ne se ye rempene Akufo Addo and his government aden o se when cluelessness meets unpreparedness, no? MPP, mfoni, na obi hun wo ho. Yabram, we're not going to take this, we're not having this. Mumfa, ye mpene ne mpene china. E-levy no, ye jia. Munko inko cut legislature. Munko cut executive. Munko cut judiciary. Nasi kan ambassadors, ene, wo friend deng, ambassadorial post. Any diplomatic missions, sanya many na mon cancel, na mon reduce, na mon fa computers in your hair. Legislature say you worth 275, no? You bet me the drone, I replace one. You here 275 at the maximum 4 per region. You here 64 parliamentarians. You here 211 parliamentarians. No?
Okay. So when we are discussing bull of knowledge, strength, adaptability, energy, freedom, unity, hope, peacemaking, harmony, intelligence, power of love, strength. Said in discussing bulls when you are obiabra, bobia, ebia, oboy, na ne sign, ano pepano, na ye diaka, and in discussing bulls, you know.
Okay.
Now Ghana for Tennessee, who said the another uncle for the ebu ne mine, ye nije ho. And see, this is the Adinkra symbol for failure.
What?
It's a free medical. So Adinkra symbol, who spells him, you know, yeah. A Adinkra symbol song.
Your president is now a
free medical. Who spells him, you know, yeah. A Adinkra symbol song.
Photo.
It's an Adinkra symbol for failure.
You are a failure. You are a and failure. I beg you can never make it. Said,
yan ananuma motena ase ye din krasem bo se mu mianfa we nka ho
this photo
din krasem bo fofo
happens to we have this
now back to the studio
I will tell happens to about this is where you want to use your life now oh my god you know
ya yeah, mobo wakan
wani
eti sika so o ma enya ohia mai
hey
nenam amamu a enkoyie nti no maza e come there